Chitra Banerjee Divakaruni, in conversation with Shrabani Basu, please a very warm welcome.
Thank you all for coming here. Is the mic okay? Thank you all. It's lovely to see such a lovely big crowd. Thank you, JLS. It's a pleasure to sit here in the morning with Chitra. We've been chatting away in the office room, and I think we have a really good session. So let me tell you a bit about Chitra. She needs no introduction. She's an internationally best-selling author. She's written 13 books, quite a few. Mistress of Spices, Palace of Illusions, which has been a bestseller. This is the current one, Before We Visit the Goddess. And she's based in Houston now, where she teaches creative writing at the Houston University. So without further ado, and I'm Shrabani Basu, I write daily history. We both happen to be Bengali. I think we're going to talk a lot about history and fighting today as well. So, Chitra, this is the book. It's very different from your other book. You've looked at three generations of women, and you followed them for the first time from rural Bengal through to the city in Calcutta and then on to Houston, where you live now. So why did you want to do this? Why is this important?
Well, before I start answering your question, I just wanted to thank Jayla for having me over here and all of you wonderful people for being here. It's such a big audience, I have to say I'm a little nervous, so I need lots of applause in between. So, Before We Visit the Goddess is really a very different book. Because, first of all, the structure is different. It is a novel in story. It's about three generations of women, and each chapter is a complete story, can be read as one, but all the stories are connected. And over these stories, we go to three generations, really almost four generations, a grandmother, a mother, and a daughter, beginning in a village, moving to the city of Kolkata, and then to California, and finally to Texas, where I now live. So the book kind of follows the geographical trajectory of my own life, but otherwise it's not biographical, because these women have a lot of adventures, and my life is actually quite staid and boring. I'm sure it is, but you know, what I love about the book is that the Calcutta chapter, it says in what is a sweet shop. But what is, you know, in Calcutta, when you see these sweet shops, they are all owned by men, and they have these very, very big titles like Ganesh Chandra Day, 1887, or, you know, Balaram Mallik and somebody else Mallik. And they have these men with, you know, heavy French spectacles and white quarters. And, but yours is called Durga Street. It's owned by a woman, and that was quite fascinating. But in this male-dominated world, here was this woman making sweets. So tell us about it. So the sweet shop will be started by Shabisi, who is the grandmother in the three generations. And she will name her shop after her own mother, Durga, who was a very good sweet maker in her village. So I wanted, as with all of my books, as you know, women are always at the center of the book. And though there are, I hope, wonderful and complex men characters, the highlight is always the women. And so it was very important for me to show Sabitri as a woman entrepreneur who begins a business after she's gone through a number of adventures and tragedies in her life, who begins and is successful at creating a sweet business, breaking into a male-dominated field with all of the attendant challenges. On one level, this book is about women and success. It asks the question, what does it mean to be a successful woman? Does that change as we move from one generation to another, one country to another? What remains the same, and what prices do women have to pay? And all of that is woven with Durga Street and Sabitri.
Well, you know, it's also the mother-daughter relationship, isn't it? I mean, it's their struggle, it's their achievements. But at the heart of it is also this relationship between mothers and daughters.
And you've described it so beautifully, you know, when they come together, when they grow apart, when they come together again. And how important is it? This is the first time I think you're really talking, going into detail. Was it something personal to you? Was it something you wanted to do?
Yes. This is very much a book about mothers and daughters, and you know, there'll be three sets of mother-daughter relationships. Each one is very complex, as you said. They're very close, but as is true sometimes in our closest family relationships, there's also a lot of friction, also a lot of people not agreeing with each other. I started thinking about writing this book soon after my own mother passed away. She was a very strong woman, a very strong influence on my life. For many years of my growing up, she was a single parent bringing me up in Kolkata with great difficulty, myself and two younger brothers. So I think in looking at some of the struggles that women are going through, especially Chavitri, the grandmother, who was contemporary to my mother, I think I was really thinking about mother-daughter relationships, moving out from my own out into these other relationships. And also, I think, you know, for my mother, that question of being independent and being a successful woman was very important. So I think that wove into the book.
Right. And, you know, you're talking about the Mother's Day. It's a complex book. You know, there's so many things that are happening along with it. One of the things is, which I noticed is fate and destiny are playing a big role throughout your book. It's almost like, you know, Thomas Hardy. It's a stray remark. I don't want to give away too much. We have to read the book. So, but a stray remark by daughter, you know, in terms of Chitra and that kills that marriage. And, you know, then much later, it's her own daughter making a phone call that she can't get through. And that's changing their life. So, major events in life are such as noted by these little points, turning points in their life. And it's a lot of faith and time.
Yeah, I think as with many books that I admire, starting from, you know, the Mahabharata onwards, life is a strange mixture of character and destiny, and literature certainly is the same kind of combination of what we put into our lives and then other forces outside that shape us. And I think that is a tension in the story of the goddess.
Mm-hmm.
That, and also the fact that, you know, either disaster or assistance will come from sometimes most unexpected sources. So, yeah.
So, while the women are very strong in this, you know, they all have their destinies. They know what they want to do. Sometimes they're quite manipulative as well. The men are a bit sort of passive, I would say. They're not too central at all in the book.
Well, I think the book has several very interesting male characters whom I became very fond of.
Mm-hmm.
There is Dipin Bihari, who is the manager of Kulkasi. So, in fact, he is essential to Chavitri's life, because without him, Chavitri would not be successful. So, you know, perhaps I was playing a little bit tradition where the woman is in the helpmaid position, helping the man along, and here the men are in the front. But, I mean, the women are in the front, but the men are certainly very central to their life. And sometimes these men could be strangers. Chavitri's daughter, Bela, will, for reasons that we won't go into, she will become an alcoholic. And she will find herself at a time in her life where she's all alone, cut off from the rest of her family. And it's really going to be her next-door neighbor, a young gay man, who will befriend her and who will turn her life over.
They do play very supportive roles.
Yes, they have important roles.
Mm-hmm.
But I think I have decided, long time back, that I want women in the center of my canvas. For me, that's just very important, to give the woman her space, to allow her to tell her own story in her own voice.
Mm-hmm.
For so many centuries, we haven't had that. So I feel it's really important to have that at least in my book.
Absolutely. And in fact, Bela, in her book, is the first one who moved, she's the migrant to the U.S. Your earlier books were all on migration, and that's where you started. You yourself were a migrant, and I think a lot of those are born from your experiences. And very important in all of them was titles, food. Was it the migrant in you that was thinking back and, you know, wanting to recreate the things you were missing?
Yes, partly, that's true. I think for all of us who are living as immigrants outside of India, many things about India become very important to us, and food is certainly one of them, because, you know, there's so many things of India we can't take with us, but food is easily takeable, and so it's very important. In my own home, for example, I cook Indian food most of the time, and although my two sons are Indian American, so they're American in many ways, they love their Indian food, they love their dal bhat, and I even taught them how to cook that. So I think it has a certain emotional resonance for immigrants.
And the memories, isn't it?
Memories, food is all about the memories as well. Memories, carrying on of traditions to food, history to food. And also, though, it's a living cultural thing, we change it as we go along. This is part of everyday life.
Okay.
Traditions change. Okay. In fact, sometimes it's healthy for traditions to change in accordance with what's going on around us.
And then, of course, after the experience of sort of immigration downwards, you went came forth, and you wrote Palace of Illusions, which is one of your biggest selling books, and I know many people here would want to hear about that. So in this Palace of Illusions, for those of you who don't know about it, Chitra tells the story from the point of view of Draupadi, the story of the Mahabharata, told from the point of view of Draupadi. So what's this calling to the Mahabharata? I mean, every author wants to have a go at the classics. What's this your calling? You don't have to do it. Well, I think I've been fascinated by the stories of the Ramayana and the Mahabharata. I think we are so blessed because we are in a position in Indian culture where our epics are alive and they are a part of our cultural discourse, our political discourse, our religious discourse. They are just a living part of our life. So when I was a little child living in Kolkata, my grandfather used to live in a village about 2 hours away. I was used to go and spend my summer vacation, summer holidays with him. And he was a great storyteller. In the evening, he'd get all the cousins together, and he would tell us the stories out of the Ramayana and the Mahabharata and our folk tales and our fairy tales. So actually, that has influenced a lot of my writing.
Yeah.
In other books like Sister of My Heart or Mistress of Spices, I've woven in folk tales and fairy tales. But I always was fascinated by the Mahabharata, and particularly the women in the Mahabharata, because there are strong, complex, amazing women characters in the Mahabharata, but in the original, they are kind of switched aside. And I think most epics, not just in India, but all over the world, the focus is on the men, on the intrigue, the palace intrigue that between the factions, the wars, even the weapons get more space than the women. But I was very fascinated by the women characters, especially Draupadi, because she is an unusual character. She's complex, she's strong, she's outspoken, she gets in trouble, she has, let's say, an unusual marital arrangement. And I really wanted to tell the story how she would see it. And when I was writing it, it was a big challenge. I wasn't sure. It took me a long time to research it and write it. And I wasn't sure how people would take it. So I'm very, very thankful that it has spoken to many people and touched many people's hearts.
And you took a little care. This was your decision, I presume, that you would. We know the story. This is torn between Karan and Elfie. In your book, it's very clear that you tell me that she is close to. And in fact, we have very little of our thing. We think of a being, in fact, you know. So, it was very, very interesting to see how you dealt with it. What they were.
Thank you. Thank you. When recreating, you know, a story based on another story, an epic, or any other major text, one always has to balance what we are taking from the original and what we're creating. And my hope is that I'm respectful to the original text, but there are gaps in the original text. And that's the creativity of the imagination comes in.
And I believe you are now working on Sita. That's right, my next novel, which I'm working on right now, is based on the Ramayana, and it's going to be from Sita's point of view. And it's a great challenge, and I hope and pray that I can do a great job being respectful to the original text in plural. Because as many of you know, there are many, many Ramayans, And one of the major ones that I'm following is the Bengali one by Chitra Banerjee.
Okay.
And then again, looking at the entire adventure from Sita's point of view. So, is the writing process on, or is it
the writing process on?
Yes, I'm very excited that Palace of the Nations is going to be made into a film. And thank you. And I'm equally excited that the director is this wonderful woman director. I'm sure many of you have seen many of her films, Aparna said. So, I'm excited to see what she will do with my daughter.
But of course, when you're new to film, your book being made into film, you have different spices with Ashwin Rai and the image of that directing, another well known director. How was that for you?
That was a good experience. You know, one of the things I realized with film is that the book is my work. I'm responsible for the book and for making it as good as it can be. But the film is the director's work. So I have, you know, I let go of the book when the director takes it. And my hope is that if I like the director, I will like the book. They'll stay, what should I say, close to the spirit of the book. But I really don't want to control the process. Just if my heart was made into a movie in Tamil and won a number of awards. And that's so the Tamil director, Suhasini Maniratnam, took the story originally from Bengal and she said it in Tamil Nadu. And I thought that was fine. She preserved the spirit of the book and that was all.
I see this one definitely being optioned as well. It's just such a beautiful, moving book.
Well, at the end, you're like welling up. Like they say, from your mouth to God's ears.
So, you know, again, it's all about writing. And, you know, many here are aspiring authors. You see trait in writing as well. So, in the first of the young aspiring authors, tell them how you felt it when you went to the U.S. It was a lot, as you said, the integration process. Stories that you saw around you. How did you research them? Did you go to think, women characters? Did you meet people?
Yeah. Well, my journey into authorhood has been a surprising one for myself because, unlike many people who write, and possibly many of you here in the audience who are writers, you may have known from a young age that you wanted to be a writer. For all the years when I lived in India, I never thought I would be a writer. I always loved literature. I was studying literature with the idea of teaching in college, which of course I do now, though now I teach all creative writing courses, so I'm only working with writers.
Mm-hmm.
But I love literature, but I never thought that I would be creating books, creating literature. And I really think immigration made me into a writer because it pushed me out of my comfort zone. And although, you know, that is not always fun when that happens to you, I think being pushed out of the comfort zone is actually very good for writers. Because then you're forced to look at things newly. So I came from a very traditional Bengali family, and when I moved to study in the United States, I was living all on my own for the first time. I was very homesick in the beginning, and I began to think about my culture in a way that I never thought it would. When I was immersed in Bengali culture, Indian culture, and Indian culture, I never thought about it, just took it for granted. But when I was so far away, and I would just, you know, I would just remember, and I would just long for things like some music in the end, Bengali songs that I would overhear in Kolkata, or the street food, or just things like that, or the close family relationships.
Mm-hmm.
It became very important. So I wanted to write about those things, because I also felt that I was losing touch with my culture. As I was so immersed in my Indian and my American life now, I was forgetting. So I really began writing as a very personal action against forgetting. And I started that after my grandfather died, because it was to kind of for me to remember him.
Mm-hmm.
it was very personal. For years I was a closet writer. I didn't show anyone my work. I didn't know if it was any good. And in fact, some of that early writing was quite bad. So it was. And I share this with you because sometimes people think that to be a successful writer, you have to be very good from day one. That was not the case with me, but I kept at it. And I joined a writer's group. Several people got feedback, edited, and that's what I say to my students. Mm-hmm. You want to get better, you have to revise, you have to edit. That's been in my process.
Of course. No,
that's so interesting. I mean, I don't know if there are writer's groups here in India, but they would really help. I know they do help over there. It's not even like having someone else do their job, isn't it? They give you a completely unbiased sort of because otherwise we're too close to our own writing. It's very hard. So I write something, okay, so I go through this process, I write it, I see it, I'm amazed, it is so good. It's like a thing that brings so much computer into the world. You know, it's not a wonder, you look at everything, now it's time to do it. So I don't know. Objectivity, I can't really tell what's good. So even now I have a writer's group. We meet once a month on our computers, like we meet all over the United States. So we meet to Skype and we discuss each other's work. Very, very helpful to me. In fact, I thank my fellow writers in my writer's group for the best of this book.
And you've also written for children.
You've done some children's books. Was this a person for you telling stories to your son, like your grandfather was, you know, to you? Is that how
you Well, my children's books, which some of you may know, The Conch Bearer and Dixie Song, which is set during Indian independence, and really stars children who got involved in the independence struggle, which is a real historic fact. And then The Conch Bearer is a fantasy adventure, it's a trilogy. Surprisingly, yes, my own children were a part of it, but really I started writing for children after 9/11, when there was a lot of backlash against, you know, immigrants and against our community because we looked different, we looked dangerous. As we know, whenever there is an upheaval of some kind in communities, often there's a kind of need to look for a scapegoat. So my community was undergoing a lot of racist attacks at that time. And I remember I had gone to the grocery with my little son one evening, and when I was coming out of the grocery, these young white men drove up in a big truck and they shouted obscenities and they said, "Go home," they said to us, "Why don't you go home?" And it was just a shocking incident. And I thought to myself, you know, all my life I've been writing books for adult readers, hoping to create the cross-cultural experience, hoping for people of my community to see themselves reflected, hoping for people of other communities to understand, to create a discussion. But I said to myself, you know, young men like the ones in this class, I'm never going to pick up my books anyway. I'm just preaching to the choir. And I said, I want to start writing for young readers before their minds are closed off. And so really my book for young readers in some ways was a political action on my part.
Okay, what was the sort of response?
The response has been very positive. A lot of school districts have adopted my books. So I often go and talk to school children, and I think that's very healthy because it's a wonderful cross-cultural conversation that opens up.
Right. So your first 9/11 novel was a children's book. That's really interesting. And now, of course, we're coming to it today. It's the 20th. It's going to be this big, you know, man taking over in the White House. As an immigrant, who's written about immigrant experiences?
I feel a little differently about Trump maybe than many of the people that I've been hearing, many of the intelligentsia, as it were. I did not vote for Trump. That was not my choice. But I respect the election process in a democracy. Just because I and some people like me did not want him, you know, most of America, a large portion of America did want him. We have the process. He is now the president. Now, instead of
being negative about it. We have to say, all right, what can we do in this Trump government to reduce racism, to make the multicultural conversation a big part of who America is? So I think in some ways, the duty of writers is even more now to keep that conversation going, to reduce a sense of make America white again equals make America great again. No, but we have something to do. I tell my students who were kind of upset, and I said, no, I mean, being a writer in an easy time is an easy task. Being a writer where your voice is not going to be heard so easily, that's when it's important to be a writer. So I feel that that's really, thank you. So I feel that this is a real opportunity for us to create the discourse that we want to happen in America. And of course, you know, there are other ways. There are other ways of, so there will be reaching out. There will be the post-competitive novelizing, right? I think this is a time. You know, I was speaking to one of my Russian writer friends, and she said, this is how we've been writing in Russia for a long time, so it's not something that people don't do. You are just starting, you are entering a time in America when you might have to speak where you're not in line with the government. And perhaps that's already been happening, just not as much. But you said it's clear, Richard. I mean, what do you say so far? You have such a, you know, you're down to the year as a writer. How is the relationship to be this sort of feeling as this process is going on and the, you know,
I think the one fear there is that, you know, people often take what the leader is saying and they interpret it. Okay?
And some said all kinds of things. Some of which he doesn't necessarily mean in a very kind of concerted negative fashion. He just says it because, as you know, when Trump says something, he tweets it. Actually, my husband and I were saying he should be treated like our children. His computer and phone should be taken away from him. He says something. But other people might interpret it as it's okay to be racist. And that is the danger. That is the danger. So we have to have enough people speaking out against it, acting in the proper way, following the procedure against it.
So I've spoken a lot. I know there's a lot of questions there. We will delve in line. We need to look for people with
Hi. Good morning.
Hello.
So, you know the great thing?
And if you would just give me your name.
My name is Anupam. One of the great things about our epic stories from our culture is that they are timeless. So, even if you look at Mahabharata and Ramayana, you know.
So, the great thing about our epic is that they are timeless. So, even Mahabharata and Ramayana, you know, even today, when we read it or, you know, hear about the stories, there's moral, ethical, thought conflicts that you can relate to even today, you know, in our context. Now, when you see, you know, when you think about Draupadi's story, do you think Draupadi's story also is like a mirror to, let's say, you know, the modern woman, you know, what she goes through every day in her life and the conflicts and the dilemmas that she has to deal with. Is Draupadi's story also as timeless as the rest of the Mahabharata and Ramayana?
The question is Draupadi's story as timeless as the rest of the Mahabharata and the Ramayana? And definitely, yes, I think so. I think one of the reasons the epics are so interesting still to us is that they're telling human stories that are very timely. And particularly Draupadi's story is very timely because I think in many ways she's a rebel. She speaks her mind. And she's complicated. And I think those are all, those are all facets of the woman today. So yes, I feel that. And in a different way, I feel the same about Sita. I think her character has been misinterpreted many times
in our cultural discourse, and that she is much more complicated than we give her credit for being. And my hope is that she will appear that way to my novel. That's my hope and prayer. Thank you.
We could also leave a little time to read.
Yeah. Okay, we'll take a little. It's about to, you know, so we've been talking. I'm about to get prepared to read a little bit, so maybe we'll have a little reading and then get on to the next question. Yeah, okay. So I thought, you know, the biggest part of a writer is really her book. So I thought I would share with you a little bit a dramatic moment from the life of Savitri, the grandmother. Mm-hmm. And Savitri, as I was telling you, is of my mother's generation. She grows up, she's in a very poor family in a village in Bengal. And she's very smart. She wants to go to college. And that's not something that her family can afford. And it's not common at that time for village girls to come to the cities and go to college. But her mother asked one of the richer women who has a home in Kolkata, and this rich woman's name is Leela Moy. And in a way, grudgingly says, okay, if your daughter can get admission, she can live in my house and go to college. And now what happens is, Savitri comes, she's staying with Leela Moy, where she's not well seated, but she happens to meet Leela Moy's son. And Leela Moy's son and she fall in love, secretly. And Leela Moy doesn't know anything about it. And so this son, whose name is Rajiv, takes a red quilt up to the terrace and they meet there at night. Nobody knows about it. And this is the part that happens right after that. Summer had descended upon Kolkata with epic vengeance. Savitri came back from college, bedraggled with sweat, craving a bath, cold water cascading over her body in the maid's bathroom. But a servant was waiting. Leela Moy wanted to see her. Savitri was surprised. Let me drink some water, she said. Change my sari. The woman scrunched up her face and shook her head. Ranima's waiting. Better come right now. The first thing Savitri saw when she entered the room was a red quilt from the terrace, crumpled on the floor like the pelt of a dead animal. The blood rushed to her head and then away. She had to hold on to the doorframe. When her vision cleared, she looked around for Rajiv, who would surely defend her. But there was only Leela Moy, and behind her, Paro, hands on her lips, hips swollen with satisfaction. So the next part is when Leela Moy really abuses Savitri, scolds her, shouts at her, and finally throws her out of the house. It is now evening time in Kolkata. Savitri doesn't know anyone. I'm going to read a little from the next part. The one thing I wanted to let you know is Savitri is going to women's college, but all the science and math classes are in the men's college a little distance away, and she has to walk there every day for those classes. Savitri stood at the tram stop for a long while in the oppressive dust, carrying her small painted trunk. Finally, she boarded a tram that would take her to the men's college. She could think of no other place. She opened her handbag, so light, and looked down at the frighteningly few rupee notes in there. Her trunk was light, too. Haru, the maid servant, had followed her to her room, rummaged to it, and taken whatever she had wanted. Savitri had been too heartsick to protest. The men's college loomed wearily in the gloom. She slipped through the gate, thankful that the gateman wasn't there to stop her, and ran up the stairs. On the second story, at the end of a corridor, there was a small room with a plaque on it. Women's common room. She had gone there once, exploring with her friends. It was piled with dusty furniture and smelled of mice droppings, but there was a bolt on the inside and a small toilet. She could stay there for the night. Tomorrow, she couldn't handle the thought of tomorrow yet.
When she reached it, the door to the common room was padlocked. The strength went out of her, and she slid to the floor, unable to hold in her sobs any longer. Terror and rage, but foremost was the fear of what might happen to her tonight when the night watchman came by. Would he throw her out onto the street? Would he do worse? Beneath the door roiled the humiliation. What would her parents, her relatives, her village say if they knew she had been kicked out of Nilamori's house like a dog? No one would care that the love she and Rajiv had felt for each other was pure and beautiful. She had been weeping too hard to hear the footsteps. When she felt a hand on her shoulder, she flinched and cried out, throwing up her arms to protect herself. And I'm going to end wickedly here, so you won't know who it is. I just keep wondering because everybody has so many questions. Do you want to read this talk? One from Palace of Illusion?
Can I read something from Palace of Illusion?
I think I would love that.
Okay. All right, I'm going to read from the most iconic, possibly the most famous scene out of Draupadi's life, the Vastaharan scene. Okay? So she is in the court. Dushyasana has dragged her to the court. She's appealed to her husband. She's appealed to Bhishma and all the elders. Nobody can do anything. I'll read a little bit from this portion. Only a tiny part of what happens in the scene. The bard sings of what occurred when Dushyasana took hold of my sari to pull it away, exposing my nakedness to all eyes. How more and still more fabric appeared until he was exhausted with tugging. Was it a miracle? I don't know. I had shut my eyes. My body would not stop trembling, though I willed it to. I clutched my sari in my fist, as though I could save myself with that futile gesture. The worst shame a woman could imagine was to befall me. I, who had thought myself above all harm, the proud and cherished wife of the greatest kings of my time. Now they sat frozen as I struggled with the shatter. The sorceress had said to me, "When in great trouble, rest your mind on someone who loves you." I tried to call up my brother's face, but all I could imagine was how enraged and helpless he would feel when he heard of what had been done to me. Then, maybe because there was no one else who could help, I thought of Krishna. He owed me nothing. We were not related. Perhaps that was why I could fix my mind on him without being swept away by the anger that arises from expectation. I thought of his smile, the way it would appear on his face for no reason. The sounds of the courtroom faded, the shackles grunt, the whispers of the watchers. Suddenly, I was in a garden. There were swans in the lake, a tree that arched above, dropping blue flowers, the sound of water falling as though the world had no end. The wind smelled of sandalwood. Krishna sat beside me on a cool stone bench. His glance was bright and tender. "No one can shame you," he said, "if you don't allow it." It came to me in a wash of amazement that he was right. Let them stare at my nakedness, I thought. Why should I care? They, and not I, should be ashamed for shattering the bounds of decency. Was that not miracle enough? Thank you for that lovely reading, sister. Okay, questions.
I have two short questions.
Tell your name.
My name is Deepa, and I'm privileged to have a signed book by you by the Medley Foundation, California.
Thank you.
So, I read all your books, but Palace of Illusion scores a couple of notches above the others. Do you also feel that as the creator of all the books?
You know, talent, the question is, you feel that talent is beyond the others. Talent is a particularly powerful story because I have to say, I had the help and the blessing of the epic, right? That story is amazing. That story is so complex and multi-layered that I really think it's beyond what most writers are writing in this present time. It just has a resonance. And I think that resonance really blessed this book as I was writing it. So it's just, there's something about ethics, there's something about myth. It touches up very, very deeply inside us human beings, more than modern stories, although those are also important.
Thanks. And the second is about before we visit the goddess, in that Bela has an accident before she actually enters the temple. So do you really believe that it's necessary to cleanse yourself before you visit the goddess? Or is it a process which happens after we visit the goddess?
That's very interesting because the cycle before we visit the goddess, in the book there's on the fourth level, there is a goddess temple in the city of Houston, the temple of Goddess Meenakshi, and you know, one of the granddaughter Tara will actually go to the temple. So there's an actual meaning before we visit the goddess, before going to the temple. But really, I think as with many of my books, Talents of Illusions included, this is really a spiritual journey of three generations. And in each generation, the woman has to come in touch with the divinity inside, because I really believe that very strongly, that we have the sacred, the goddess is right inside of us. But before we can come in touch with that, sometimes we need to go through and grow through tragedy. Sometimes we need to learn things like compassion and forgiveness, including forgiveness for ourselves. So that's the process that these lives in the book will go through before, at the end, I hope I have shown that they do come to a kind of visiting the goddess, a knowledge and an understanding of their sacred self.
Morning, ma'am. Ma'am, like you spoke about Savitri, and since you spoke about Bengali culture, normally when we think about Bengali culture, what we know in this part of the country, it's about liberated women. When we talk about Durga Puja, it is the goddess going back to her parents. So, when you're talking in terms of Savitri, she is a woman trying to be liberated, come out of the house, attain education. Now, what would that be vis-a-vis the women here who are into parda or stuck into traditions? Are the challenges more for women who are trying to be liberated or more for those who are stuck into traditions?
That is a very good and complex question. And of course, I can only answer as a writer from my limited perspective. I think women in all kinds of different positions, as soon as we try to change the status quo, we're going to be pushing against something. So my status quo might be here, someone else's might be here, someone else's might be here. I think what is important is what is inspiring us to change. And I'm not saying that all change is necessarily good. Only the change that I feel I need in my life and I have a good reason for needing it, that's the one that's worth pursuing, because change comes at a cost. And so before we invest in that, we have to be really, you know, we have to be really committed to that change. So I think every woman, wherever she is, she's whoever wants to change, wants to be more herself in whatever way she wants to be. It's a very valid struggle. It's as much in Kolkata as here in Jaipur, right? It's as important everywhere. And I certainly hope that the society around these women will honor that desire to change, to progress, to become more themselves, and will aid women in it. Women as well as men need to help women who are trying to change for the better. Okay.
Right. We should take a question for the back. Are there any hands in the back? Let's take some in the back, yes. Yeah. Keep them short because we
ran
out of time. So,
yeah. Hello, my name is Kanti. My question is, since you
were interested in women's psyche, then how has feminism evolved from the point where it started about the women's demand of political and social equality to now, when writers like you and Sachi Desh Pandey in that long silence present a humble viewpoint of life, a different viewpoint of life from a new eye. So how has it evolved?
The question is, how has feminism evolved? It's really a very large question that I won't be able to address fully at all over here. And I would say that what writers are most interested in, at least I'm speaking for myself, is how through individual lives we can give a sense of a larger culture. So Savitri's, her push to become independent, to become successful, to become educated, and some of which will work out for her and some which won't, is ultimately a human story. My job as a writer is to try and make you invest in her story so that you become sympathetic to her fight. And then through her, you become sympathetic to others who are undergoing those struggles. Now, India is a very interesting, very rich culture where feminism occurs at so many different levels. Some women are extremely emancipated and powerful, and at the other end, we have some women whose lives are very, very different. And I hope that we are aware of that multiplicity and sympathetic to it as we read books in which women protagonists are at the center.
Okay. So one more from the back.
Okay, one from this part.
Are there any mics present?
Will somebody come to you?
Okay.
Hi, ma'am. My name is Priyanka. Though you have mentioned how you influenced the writers from your details that you have heard from your grandfather, I have a question. I mean, talking about Sita or Draupadi, I mean, we were in an era of, we are so rudimentary about few things in our life. Looking out of a box, it's completely different thing. So I want to ask one thing, when you were writing this book, the character of Draupadi must have felt it. So even in the worst situation, seeing the positive side, like what we narrated, when the thing was happening, so how it came, and I'm sure it wasn't easy to, I hope
Thank you. So you're asking how is it possible to write Draupadi's character because her experiences are so amazingly different from ours. And the answer is really, I think, true for all the characters I write, which is I have to imagine that character. I have to spend some time imagining what the character is like externally as well as internally. I have to kind of get into the space of that character. And with Draupadi, that was a big challenge. Also, I have to get the voice right. So when I was writing Palace of Illusions, just the first few pages, I wrote and rewrote and rewrote until I felt I got her voice right. Mm-hmm. And then I felt her character, I could feel it like inside of me, then I could start writing. And until I feel, like even before we visit the goddess, I had to feel the character inside of me, her tragedy, her triumph. Mm-hmm. I had to feel like when she's crying, I'm also on the point of tears. And when she's really happy, there's a moment when Savitri will discover a new Bengali sweet, which is named after her mother. And she's like, it's the happiest moment of her life. And I had to feel it before I could write it. That's how I write. Other writers write differently.
There is some sound from back on it.
I guess being an author, you get the privilege of choosing what happens to all our favorite characters. They're just reading there in anger and happiness that this could happen and that could happen. So when I read the original Mahabharata, the question that is always hinted that there is something between Draupadi and Karan, Draupadi is attractive. So the question of if it's Karan or Arjun has been there since quite long. What made you choose Karan? I've always wondered that when the book ends and this is last scene that he floats into eternity and Karan is there to hold a hand, what made you choose Karan to be the one Draupadi chooses?
That's a great question about Karna in Palace of Illusions. So, as you pointed out very rightly, the hints are all there in the original Mahabharata and certainly in Chitra Banerjee Mahabharata, which is the Bengali Mahabharata that was one of my major sources. The hints are always there. What we don't have in the original, because we don't have it in other moments of Draupadi's life, is how is she feeling? She's not going to say much, she's not going to do much. She's a very honorable character, she's in a marriage. But how is she feeling? That's the part that isn't there, and that's the part that I imagined. And because of that, I came up with that imagined end. This is also happening in her mind. And I hope you liked it.
Thank you.
Do we have mics on this side? Yeah, we've got a mic there.
Good morning, ma'am. I see you are a very fearless woman, and I like to give a suggestion and a question also for your new work that is in process about Ramayana. The main story starts after the incident of Surpanakha. The main part starts and about to fight the villain starts with the act of Surpanakha. But is it not true that could it be just not the literal sense that when Surpanakha went home and they said that from Nakatwachari? Well, is it just the literal Nakatwana or was it the like Lakshman and Surpanakha had a nice time and he refused to accept her as a second wife and then when she went home and that incident happened? I would like you to explore in this angle also of the woman, like what could be the real story behind that.
I think those are wonderful suggestions. Surpanakha is certainly going to be important in this text, in this book that I'm writing. In fact, I hope to touch upon many of the important women characters whose lives will intersect with Sita. Kaikeyi is one of them. Ahalya is one of them. Surpanakha is one of them. Mandodari will be one of them. So how Sita relates and understands what happens to her is these other women is going to be part of her story. I'm not sure I'm a fearless person at all. I'm often very afraid, but then I push through the fear because sometimes I feel some stories are really important and they need to be told. There's one lady there who's been here in the glasses. Can you just give her the mic?
Hi, my name is Kamali, and I have to share this because I read Palace of Illusions, and I also read extensively on spiritual matters. But your exposition at the end about Susan's relationship with God, what they call the Mahaprasthana thought, right at the end, is kind of my go-to place because I am more familiar with English, and possibly it just struck home to my heart. So thank you so much. No questions, just a compliment. Thank you.
Thank you. I wanted to say some thank you. Thank you for that very wonderful comment. I wanted to say something. As I've been writing more and more, I think the spiritual dimension has become more and more important in my writing. So that I see our journey in the world ultimately as a spiritual journey. Yes, it's a social journey. Yes, it's an emotional journey. But ultimately, it's a spiritual journey. It's a journey towards understanding. It's a journey towards compassion. It's on many levels. The journey is always spiritual. So I'm so glad that you picked up on that.
Mic somewhere in the middle. Are there two mics there? Come here, Sam. Come on. Yeah.
My name is Dinuka, and we seem to be keeping on coming back to Palace of Illusion because you took the greatest story ever told, and you told the lovely version of it. So when you wrote it, were you just telling a story, or was there a lesson in there? Meaning, I mean, when I read it, in fact, I'm rereading it for the fourth time now as we speak. And when I reread it, I feel there's a big lesson in there of what not to do. For example, I mean, those three things that Vyasa tells Draupadi, which he actually ends up doing and this causes all that destruction. So is there, when you wrote it, did you mean to, you know, sort of give a warning to women of how not to be and how not to behave, or were you just telling a story?
Well, that's a great question. My job, I think, as a writer, is to primarily tell a story. Because if I was going to give lessons, it just wouldn't be as good, right? The story has to speak to you, the reader. And the lesson is whatever you will gain from the story. The story has many complexities. My hope is to bring out those complexities. My hope is to make you ask questions. But the answer has to be yours. Because I really believe that the whole process has two parts. The writer is one, the story is one, and the reader is the final one. And so it could be that each one of us will read the same book, but we will get the lesson we need out of it. I certainly hope so with all my books. Right in front, we have a question. I think we have time for maybe one question. Okay. It's going to be good.
Hello. My name is Noya. I was listening to describe the process of becoming a better writer, and you emphasized editing. I'm currently I just started my editing process in my first novel, and I find it very overwhelming. So I was wondering how you do editing, what your tips are, any good techniques. Would you suggest any web links or books? And also, my book has lots of scenes that I'm not sure how to tie together, and what type of system to use, whether to go with the flashbacks and different points of view. What suggestions do you have for getting that idea to how to go forth with editing?
Thank you. That is a very complex question and requires a long answer. I recommend for writers in the audience, go to my blog, which is on my website, chitradivakaruni.com. I have numbers of articles which are about writing, different aspects, including revision. So you might want to take a look at it. The most important thing I would say is maybe this is the time when you give your book to someone else to read and see what the feedback is. Which parts are confusing, which parts are working well, because that's when we need some other eyes to look at our work. Okay? So I would really recommend that. And a little distance. Put it away for a month. And I always see when I go back to my work after a month or so, I see it much more clearly. Otherwise, you're so close to it, it's hard to see it. Okay? I know I was told that time is up. I know you have more questions. Please come to my Facebook page, come to my Twitter. Once I'm back home and I have more time and internet, I will. I love listening and hearing what readers have to say. I will try my best to answer all your questions. Thank you all for being here. Thanks to Shrabani for being the moderator. Thank you for the Chitra Banerjee. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Chitra and Shrabani. It's very lovely to have you on stage with us this morning. Thank you. So everyone, I'm sure that many of you will be staying for the next session with Ruchi Kapoor. We will begin that session at 12:30.